wonderful speaker. I had the opportunity to hear him personally during the university guidance conference last year, and I'm sure that you're going to carry a lot with you back home today. Without any further ado, let me just invite Arjun over and so that he can address you guys. Please welcome Mr. Arjun Puri.
It's when you meet people who come from universities and are professors, you must first ask them what their discipline is. So I, by profession, I'm a history professor. But I teach the story of cities through food. So my first class, any introduction course, is understanding India through biryani. Okay? I'll sort of walk you through a bit of my story. And somewhere we're going to try and find a connect. The other thing that I usually talk about, and across homes in India, and I get booed a lot, is a football team I support called Arsenal. Usually India is full of Manchester United fans and Chelsea fans. Mostly people I call glory hunters. But we'll get that. How many of you have watched the EPL? How many watch the English Premier League? Okay, it's quite a few. Are there any Arsenal fans here? Yeah, okay, the story of my life. It's just me against the rest of India. Okay, so I grew up in Calcutta. I went to the oldest boys' school in India to study. So generationally, it's the most traditional school. It was set up by the British in the early 1800s. Very strong school, very traditional, a lot of legacy. The school started in 1836, okay, so there's a lot of focus on overall development. Now, when I was growing up, I was really bad at math, okay, extremely bad at mathematics. Now, how many of you here genuinely think you're bad at math? Put your hands up and put it up confidently. Awesome. This is great, okay. It's not bad to be bad at math. Some of your teachers are math teachers, but try and not look into their eyes right now, okay? So when I was growing up, I was made to believe that if I wasn't good at mathematics, I wouldn't know anything in life. It was like the holy gospel, it was the truth. Oh my God, you're not good at math, you're going to be a failure for the rest of your life. Now that fear of mathematics overtook understanding the subject. So when I was growing up, my parents made it a point for me to attend as many math tuitions as possible. Now, India's the only country in the world where to get better at something you're bad at, you spend more time. Okay. So we're sent to both tuitions, 1, 2, 3, 4. And I'm an only child, so my parents obviously didn't think there was anything wrong with me. It was mathematics. So with 4 tutors, still failing math, and learning more about Led Zeppelin and Pink Floyd and Rolling Stones, because one of the best well-known drummers in Calcutta was my math tutor. So he saw no scope in understanding trigonometry. So I started learning the drums, and started learning how to play to a beat, started listening to the Doors, the Beatles, the Stones, and this complete education in music allowed me an introductory course to culture. General hierarchy of education in high school in India is science, commerce, nothing works out, humanities, what will this person do in life? So these are the 3 different structures. When I was growing up, I always wondered, was there a written law to tell me that one discipline is more important than the other? And is that the reason why most of us are aspirationally looking at IIT, but not to study engineering, but to secure a salary? So those questions came to me very, very young. Now, given how bad I was at math and having zero understanding of physics or chemistry, science was obviously pulled up. But I really enjoyed understanding how psychology works, what's in your mind. I really want to know what philosophy did. I read a lot when I was growing up, so I wanted to know more about literature and poetry. But being a boy, I was asked, what do you want to be when you want to grow up, a librarian or a school teacher? And that made me question another thing, that the most underrated profession in this country is being a teacher. And they are the people that shape your lives, they're the kind of people who give up their lives to make sure you lead a great life. So when my housemasters would come and chat with us, I'd always wonder, why would we encourage to be teachers? And which is when I'm going to ask you, how many of you here want to be a teacher? 0, 1, raise your hand higher, come on. Okay, 4 of you, 5 of you. I'm so proud because 5 of you are what I'm going to call the minority report, okay? Because the rest of the country doesn't think that your age that you can even imagine being a teacher. So, when I was growing up, I was told if I become a teacher or a librarian, I'll be literally in a kurta pajama ringing a bell at 1:26, school is over. Now imagine having that image in your head, right? It's scary. So I wrote a letter saying why I should study humanities. I got called into an office for a rollicking. And I was told at a very young age, humanities is for girls. Now imagine you're a 17-year-old boy who's on the cricket team or the hockey team, boxes, plays rugby, and is suddenly typecasted into being a girl, okay? Education. education does not have gender. Remember that. Education should never have gender. You study what you love, full stop. It's very important for you to realize that. So I ended up studying commerce. Okay? And I never understood accountancy. There was something in accountancy called LIFO and FIFO. Last in, first out, first in, first out. And I thought to myself, why am I studying this? Then whatever you want, last or first, as long as I get my marks, right? And I never had that sense of responsibility to want to know more, which is the worst thing that happened in academia. If you're not curious, if you're not hungry to know more, why do you study? You know, when I was delivering my first TED talk, I did something around why you must chase what you love. And I did it completely around a quote I read when I was very young. There's an American poet whose name is Charles Bukowski. Okay? And Bukowski said, find what you love and let it kill you. I never tried to be someone else. I had a very clear understanding at a young age that science wasn't for me. I was curious about how things worked, how tires, you know, went in circles for a car to move. But I wasn't going to build those tires or the car. I just wanted to sit and get from point A to point B to do something I love. At 17, how many of you will raise your hands and say, I want to be a good human being? I want to contribute to society. I want to make a difference in the world I live in. Because none of these things are going to be you. None of these things are things you get marks on. You know, and wherever I go, the one thing I really talk about is India's obsession with marks. And now I speak with full responsibility as the Dean of Admissions and probably the country's number one private college. We're what, number one in law, we're incredible liberal arts. But I must tell all of you that when we look at admissions, we look at the person. And it's very important we realize that. Because when I was applying to college to the US, to the UK, it wasn't just the grade. All of you have a name. Your name signifies who you are. Not a percentage. You're not 91 or 96 or 61 or 74. You have a name. And no one's going to come and say, hey, how are you? You're 95%. Does it work like that? Hey, how are you? You're better at passing on our things. So why do we therefore later at some point develop this crazy hangover of this grade and this mark that's going to define the rest of my life? It's very important. These are things that I'm telling you because this will shape the future of India. If today some of you are studying something that you're not passionate about, you will always be second best. You know why? Because there's someone who's passionate about it. When passion and commitment is there in academics, and in our case it's just chasing something we're not that good at, that person will always be 2 steps ahead of you. And this is when you realize that each of you sitting here is good at a particular subject. So I started applying for jobs, okay? I applied for over 100 jobs, heard back from them, okay? And I was like, what's wrong with these guys? I was called Captain Martin, you know, why are they not hiring me? And I started realizing a very important thing. Your milestone should be only existing in small boundaries and borders. If you are head boy in school, that's great to get into college, but that's where it kind of ends. If you got great in college, that's all it helps you get your first job. Remember that you're building blocks and your timelines are very short term on that front. So in school, if you play cricket for the school team, it doesn't mean that you go to work, you're like, boss, I was an opening batsman, then I went to your class, it doesn't. So you have to keep breaking these timelines for your own benefit. So when I started applying, a friend of mine said, she said, why don't you apply to Merrill Lynch? Now, Merrill Lynch is the biggest investment bank in the world. JP Morgan, Goldman Sachs, Merrill Lynch, Morgan Stanley, they own the world, okay? And the first thing that Merrill demanded was a maths test. Okay. I was like, look, you know, there's no chance in hell I'm going to pass this. And she said, it's online. What's the best you can do? Just try it. So I went there. I kid you not, I just randomly tick boxes. Like, I didn't read some questions. When I heard from Merrill, like 10 days later, I was shocked. Okay. And they said, okay, you've passed our first round of screening. And I was like, how? So they said, you know, we're going to get you to come to London. Great, and you stay here, you fly in, and they take amazing care of you. So I got to London a few days before then, and I was staying with my flatmate who I knew for my debating years, who was head boy Bishop Bartlett Jindal, who goes by the name of Chow, because he's the only man I know in the history of mankind who can have 6 plates of Chow in one sitting. It's not easy, when they come really hungry and happy, but having 6 plates in an average of Chow meal is not easy, but Chow still does it. So I called up Chow and I said, can I come and stay with you? He said, yeah, sure, come with me. Don't worry, just come, you know, come a week in advance, stay with me, so I'll, you know, book my tickets, whatever. Now, I'm going to tell you a very important lesson, which is you got to hold on to something you love, and for me that's awesome. Okay, now that's 12 years old. I started supporting a football team. I started supporting Arsenal because my father and whole family supports United. So I wanted to support a football team to just irritate them. And I just took to Arsenal. I was like, this is a great team. I was 12 years old, I was in London, I went to Highbury. Arsenal were rebuilding that team. They had Vieira, they had Bergkamp, they had some great side, the Overmars, then Henry. It was just such an incredible time to be in Arsenal. So I went to the ground. I felt like I was home. My father took me, quite disgusted. We went in. Arsenal won 3-0 against West Ham. My life changed and I became a Gooner for life. And I'll also tell you that I'm getting married. April and my wife is the biggest United fan in the world. But like I said, forgiveness is a key element in growing. So we got to keep forgiving. We got to be a big person, keep forgiving, keep moving on. So when I'm at Charles House, Charles had only one request. He said, you know, on Fridays I do laundry. Now this statement made no sense to me. I said, okay, prepared for the biggest interview of my life. Okay. What's the last thing in my mind? Socks. Okay. When I'm preparing for anything in life, you only look at a shirt, at a tie, at a jacket, at trousers, at shoes. No one looks at socks. And I insist for the rest of your life, keep in mind that socks are important. Okay. I wake up for the interview on a Saturday morning at 6 o'clock. My today's first call's at 7. Okay. I'm up ironing everything, ready. All night I've seen drafts and equations and the different ratios which have made no sense to me. Start getting ready. And I think in the washing machine. And I look at my suitcase and I can't see a single pair of socks. I have like 4 pairs and some of which weren't even used. So I see Chow proudly walking with some breakfast and he's like, all the best today's your day, broke day. Thanks, man. Like, where are my socks? And he's like, oh, I washed all of them. And I said, even the clean ones. He's like, yeah, even the clean ones. I thought I put in one run. I'm like, what logic is this? I mean, so at this point I can do 2 things. One, kill him there. Second, let's go for the interview, come back and see what I do. The day before, I had bought a pair of Arsenal football socks. Okay? Because I play football on campus. Now, if any of you play football, you know stockings come up and they come up to your knees. And no one ever wears trousers over them because it looks extremely awkward. I had an option. So I wore my Arsenal football stockings for the biggest interview of my life. Okay? When I got there, and this is the crazy part, when I got there, everyone was like, what's he wearing underneath his trousers? And so I told some people this would laugh, you know, it's an Indian thing, and just completely they kind of see your hand. When I went there, I must tell you this, it's so important to hold on to something you love, that I went into that interview, the moment I sat down, my trousers went up a bit, and 5 people looked at me and said, what are you wearing? And I said, oh, you know, socks and what the people are like, what's going to happen this year in the league? Oh, and as a simple Arsenal's going to finish fourth. We finish fourth like all the time. So they started laughing. And the next thing, you would not believe it, the next 1 hour was the greatest conversation I've ever had. Because we started speaking about footballing rivalry. Now, I grew up in Calcutta, but my grandfather played talking for a moment, but now they're here. And all rivalries essentially have to do with a sense of religion or boundary. So when East Bengal plays Mohun Bagan, it's essentially saying Calcutta versus Bangladesh. So it's essentially saying the Hindu side of Bengal is the Muslim side of Bengal. And in Calcutta, when East Bengal wins, the price of Hilsa fish goes up because people celebrate. And if Mohun Bagan wins, the price of prawns go up. And these guys are fascinating. And then the conversation moved to Madrid and Barcelona, Basque and Catalan. Rangers Celtic, Catholic Protestant, India Pakistan cricket. I was like, okay, don't get me there. But just think about it. For the next 1 hour, in the biggest investment bank in the world is known, we spoke about things I love. Things no one's ever graded me on. Things no one ever said, congratulations, 91% on your Arsenal test. No one ever gives you grades of being a good human being. If you're walking down the steps, someone falls down, you go pick up that person, no one's going to come and say, well done, 91% you're a good person. Well done, you're enough. So your mind isn't conditioned to help because no one's grading you. This kid's fallen down, all of us standing and pointing at him and laughing. That kid's like, you know, and someday come back to you. But think about it. If you're being graded, you know, it's like that episode in Blacklist where, you know, people are going around looking for, looking for people to punish you. So, like, you know, if like coffee falls, rather than getting angry at the person, like, oh my god, don't do it again. 4 stars. It's like Uber ratings. You know? And they will come and be rated on like Uber ratings. So, like, okay, like, I said, a good person, we have 4 stars for you. You made a really good sandwich. small town, you can do that. It's going to change the way you function, it's going to change the way you think, it's going to change the way you deal with other human beings. And the returns are not financial, the returns are humane. I want you all today, when you go home, to do a couple of exercises. One, on a piece of paper, please don't share this with anyone. This is for you. What you do if you don't share this with me, I'll probably not be the person. On a piece of paper, draw a line down the middle. Okay? On the left, right, love. On the right, like dislike. Hate is a very strong word. Try and avoid using it as much as you can. Love, write the subjects you love. Not where you're scoring well, but stuff that is really interesting. Stuff that you're like, man, I wish I knew more. I wish I had a sense of a stronger understanding. These might be subjects you're doing really well, which is an added advantage to you. Okay? So write that on the left. On the right, subjects you don't like. For me, that's like maths, 7, 8 times. Or whatever it is you don't like. Look at it. When it comes to choosing college, when it comes to choosing your university, look at that piece of paper. Don't share that with anyone. Don't share it with your parents. Don't share it with your best friend. Don't share it with your better half. Don't share it with anyone. Just make sure you keep that piece of paper, because that is a reflection of honesty. When you go to university, it's a new chapter. You can reinvent yourself. No one will know you then. So try and give it everything that you wish you could be. Because the only thing stopping you is you yourself. And that's very important for each of you to know. Now, if you're scared of not knowing what you want to study in college, if a brand of a college is more important than the subject you're studying, because we live in that dilemma. Should I go to that college because that college is a stamp? Should I go to the college because it's going to teach me something I really want to know more? That question is a question you can answer. No counselor, no teacher, no parent. You yourself have to be the best judge about what it is you want. Okay? Now, I get a lot of trouble for this one because there are these psychometric tests. I don't know if the school makes you do it. If they do, I'm going to say something controversial. I personally believe the most important aspect is human. Is how do you feel? If a piece of paper tells you what you have to do, tomorrow a robot will tell you how to work. And the robot is programmed by a human being. So, remember, when you're starting to think about college, and all of you are coming to that point in time where the biggest, your first life decision that people take is college. Because why all of you are studying here is not your decision. Your parents are an incredible school, a great opportunity, fabulous faculty. You were in nursery, you were putting, you had no idea what happened, and now you're in class 11. You're like, yeah, what? When you're in college, you're like, boss, this is my decision. I'm going to go to Stephen's, I'm going to Jindal, I'm going to Ashoka, I'm going to Shindal, I'm going to Hindu, I'm going to Edisa, I'm going to Edis Bangalore. Your decision. It's the first decision that you will take. More than impulse, it's passion and it's drive. And it's self-belief. And every time I've not done well in something, I've proved myself I'm better at something else. So let's not waste time. Some people will. I mean, a friend of mine who's now been in IT forever, it breaks my heart because he could have probably been one of the finest filmmakers in India, like composition directors and school and things like that. And I keep thinking like one day this guy quits, or this guy will do it. But it's our own, everyone here will come to that judgment of how afraid are you of it? How afraid are you of not having a security blanket about you? So I hope that, you know, at some point you can distinguish the risks you can take.
Being a member of the Indian society, each one of us in our stages and then have a lot of parental pressure and peer pressure. So going after your passion in life may not always be possible looking at these aspects. Some tips on how should they deal with it?
Even for me, it took a long time to channel my belief in what I wanted to do. I think the day I went investment banking at 26, I knew I was finally chasing my dream. But till 26, I had financial security because I worked for an investment manager and made a little bit of money. So I told myself that if I was an investment banking, gave me X amount of money. So if I do something for 3 years and fail regularly, I have enough to fall back on. Now, my only advice to people here is there are two ways you can chase your dream. One is the safe method, which is you give yourself into a corporate space maybe for a few years. So you have a limited amount of savings that you can rely on. And then start chasing something you really want to do. I, on an average, IIT, JEE, go and go to this coaching center, go to that coaching center. You are trying to lead the life for a child. Well, I understand that most parents will want only the best for their children. Sometimes society